This is Rebecca from chemistryismyjam.com. This video begins Unit 2 and focuses on the atom. In Unit 2, we will be introducing the parts of the atom, we will look at isotopes and ions, and how the ideas about the atom have changed over time. We will look at the electromagnetic spectrum, and then we will spend a while focusing on where electrons are located within the atom. Let's begin by talking about the parts of the atom. Here we have a simplified model of the atom that I'm going to use to try to tell you in general where things are located. You can see that there's a nucleus in the center of the atom. This is a tightly packed, super dense portion of the atom. It contains protons that have a positive charge and neutrons that have a neutral charge, or you could say no charge. Around the outside of that nucleus, you have electrons. So in this space outside the nucleus, you have negative electrons moving around the nucleus. All of these things are called subatomic particles, and they are the tiny little particles that make up the atom. This is an oversimplified model of the atom. I want to tell you some of the limitations of this drawing that you have in front of you. First of all, there's a major scale issue. We have to draw it like this so that you can kind of picture the protons and the neutrons, but this nucleus is super tiny compared to this electron cloud that's outside of it. In terms of scale, you could think of putting a pea in the center of a racetrack. The nucleus is that small compared to the rest of the atom, and most of the mass of the atom is in the nucleus. So you have this really dense, really tiny portion in the center of the atom with a whole lot of empty space outside where the electrons are located. Another issue that you run into with this model of the atom is the idea of these orbits that the electrons are in. Scientists have learned over time that these electrons are not moving in perfectly circular paths around the nucleus. They're actually found in little orbitals, which are regions of space where the electrons are located. They're not following a perfectly circular path like a planet does around the sun. So I just wanted to point out a couple of the limitations of this as we get into our discussion about the atom. But the main thing that you should know at this point is that you have protons and neutrons inside the nucleus and electrons outside the nucleus. Here you have an overview of the different particles that we have mentioned. You can see that you have protons and neutrons inside the nucleus. The electrons are outside of the nucleus. The protons have a positive charge, the neutrons are neutral, and the electrons have a negative charge. I also want to point out the difference in size between the protons, the neutrons, and the electrons. The protons and neutrons are roughly the same size. We define them as having a mass of 1 AMU. AMU means atomic mass unit, and it is based off of the size of a proton and a neutron in the element carbon-12. So an AMU is an atomic mass unit, and the proton and the neutron have a mass of roughly 1 AMU. They are roughly the same size in terms of mass. The electron is much smaller. You can see that it has a mass of 1 divided by 1800 AMU. It is almost 2,000 times smaller than the proton in terms of mass. As we move throughout the course and learn more about the atom, you're going to find that we ignore the mass of the electron. We only talk about the mass of the proton and the neutron when we deal with the mass of the atom, and that's because the mass of the electron is so tiny. A quick glance at the periodic table will tell you that there are over 100 different types of elements out there, and each one of those elements has a slightly different atom. So what's the difference between those different atoms? The difference is the number of protons. The number of protons is what determines which element you are dealing with. Like, I have an example here of ruthenium. Ruthenium has 44 protons. If you change the number of protons, you are changing the element. We call this number, the number of protons, we call that the atomic number. Another thing that you will see on the periodic table at the bottom of each block is the average atomic mass, which we will talk about later. So the atomic number, which is the number of protons, determines which element you are dealing with. In this example, I've got carbon and nitrogen, and if you were to count the little blue positive particles at the center, those are the protons, you can see that there are 6 protons over here and 7 protons over here. That is the difference between carbon and nitrogen. The number of neutrons does not matter. The number of electrons does not matter. It is the number of protons that tells me this is carbon, this is nitrogen. A quick glance at the periodic table will allow me to answer the question, how many protons are in an atom of gold? So I need to find gold on the periodic table. Gold is right here. It has a symbol of Au, and it has an atomic number of 79. Gold has 79 protons. I can do the same thing for neon. Neon is right here. It has 10 protons because its atomic number is 10. I can do the same thing for sodium, which is over here. Sodium has 11 protons because its atomic number is 11. So the difference between each of the atoms of the elements on the periodic table is the number of protons. We're going to start talking about a concept called the mass number. And the mass number is the number of protons plus neutrons. Notice that we are ignoring the mass of the electrons because they are so small. Kind of a silly way to think about that. Suppose you take your dog to the vet. The vet weighs your dog and tells you that he weighs 70 pounds. Well, then the vet tells you that your dog has fleas. Are you going to subtract out the weight of the fleas to get an accurate weight of your dog? No, because those fleas are so tiny compared to the weight of the dog that we're going to ignore them. The same thing here. With the atom, most of the mass is in the protons and in the neutrons. Those electrons are 2,000 times smaller in terms of mass, so we ignore the mass of the electrons. I also want to point out that this mass number that we are referring to is not the number that you see on the periodic table. That is the average atomic mass that we will talk about later. Mass number is not found on the periodic table. So if it's not found on the periodic table, how do we find it? Mass number is for each individual atom and is the protons plus the neutrons. So you would have to be given the neutrons in order to determine the mass number. Or if you know the mass number, you can determine the number of neutrons. In this first example, it says carbon has a mass number of 13. So this particular atom of carbon has a mass number of 13. How many protons and neutrons does it have? Take a look at the periodic table. Carbon is element number 6, so we know right away that it has 6 protons. We also know that the protons plus the neutrons equals the mass number. So if the protons plus the neutrons equals mass number, then 6 plus neutrons equals 13. You can solve for N, and you find out that there are 7 neutrons in this particular atom of carbon. That's not the case for all atoms of carbon. That is this particular atom of carbon that you are talking about. The next example is boron with a mass number of 11, and we're trying to figure out how many neutrons it has. We would look at the periodic table and find that boron is element number 5, meaning that it has 5 protons. 5 plus some number of neutrons equals our mass number of 11. 11 minus 5 tells us that the number of neutrons is 6. So subtracting the atomic number from the mass number will give you your number of neutrons. So that wraps up our introduction of the parts of the atom. Stick around for our next video, which covers isotopes.